Oh,
I want to invite you all, if you see our drummer out and around, to wish him a happy birthday.
Again, welcome to Elmwood United Methodist Church. Again, on this bright, sunny, dry day, you could have chosen to do a lot of other things other than be here, like cut the grass. You know, now, how many of us would really rather do that than be here? But I'm kind of varying the schedule just a little bit. If the children who are going to children's church would hold on till after the kids' praise team have offered their selection, I'd greatly appreciate it. So as soon as they're done singing, then you just ease on out to your Sunday school classes. And if you don't know what that is, someone out there will show you. We're just glad to have visitors. So at this time, I'd invite you to shake hands and just say, glad to see you.
Share with you the background for this song. Peter and John were at a temple gate called Beautiful when they saw a man who had been lame from birth, who asked them for money, and the answer was, I do not have gold or silver, but what I have I will give you. Stand up and walk. That was the inspiration for this song, Lord, You Are More Precious Than Silver.
Where we hear the voices of the children. It's So good to be in a place where we are able to welcome those who might be a little bit more senior in age, who are seeking to move even though their bodies don't want them to move. Lord, it's just good to be in a place where you receive us as we are, imperfect, fallible people who make mistakes and bad choices, but yet you love us anyway. This morning, Lord, we thank you for allowing us to gather and to lift up praises to you. We thank you for allowing us to explore and reflect upon how you have worked in our lives this weekend, what you call us to do and be in the coming week. Lord, again, we pray for those who have experienced loss of loved ones and that you would be in their hearts, that they would know they're not alone, that your Holy Spirit walks with them and that you have welcomed their loved ones to eternity with you. This morning, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to be a fellowship where we can smile and shake hands and hug and cry and share and laugh and just do all the things that you have called us to do as a community, as a family. This morning, Lord, it's not about how we're dressed or what we look like. It's about your Spirit seeking us and desiring to be in relationship with us. And so, Lord, I pray that we are open to your Spirit. And as we're open to the movement of the Holy Spirit, I pray that you would help us to reach out into the world and to be there for people who feel alone and depressed and discouraged and who just need to know that somebody cares. Lord, help us be that somebody. Help us represent you. We pray for a world that always seems to be at war, a world that seems to struggle with accepting people who are different and loving on people from different ethnicities and ethnic backgrounds and religious perspectives. Lord, help us to just love one another. Help us to share peace in a world where there seems to be so much turmoil and discouragement. Lord, we thank you because you have allowed us to be your hands and your heart and your eyes and your mouth. Lord, help us to represent you well. But Lord, we remember those who are in hospitals and nursing homes who might feel down, who are in pain. Lord, help them to feel comfort as well. And in the spirit of comforting one another, in the spirit of comforting those who might feel alone, in the spirit of comforting those who are in pain, let us join together in the prayer that the disciples taught us, using trespasses. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, Rachel would share the scriptures.
Good morning.
The Lord said to Moses, bring the tribe of Levi and present them to Aaron and the priest to assist him. They are to perform duties for him and for the whole community at the tent of meeting by doing the work of the tabernacle. They are to take care of all the furnishings of the tent of meeting, fulfilling the obligations of the Israelites by doing the work of the tabernacle. Give the Levites to Aaron and his sons. They are the Israelites who are to be given wholly to him. Appoint Aaron and his sons to serve as priests. Anyone else who approaches the sanctuary is to be put to death. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 7, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness.
I know a place where we can go to lay the troubles down in your soul. I know a place where mercy flows. Take the stains, make them white as snow. Like a tide, it is rising up deep inside a current that moves and makes it come alive. Living water that brings dead to life.
Overwhelmed schedules and underwhelmed souls. That song jumped in my mind because it's like, man, sometimes when my schedule gets a little out of hand, I wonder what would it be like to live in a world where there was no deadlines? What would it be like to be in a world where there were bills that had to be paid and budgets that had to be balanced? What would it be like where there was no one calling me, texting me, private messaging me, giving me things to put on my plate and to think about and to be engaged with? What would it be like if I didn't have any family or children who needed things? What would it be like if I didn't have parents to look after? What would it be like if I lived in a world like that? But you know, I don't live in a world like that. I don't know about you. But when I think about this passage and the theme from which it was drawn in the book, The Best Yes, I'm reminded of an old hymn that we used to sing in the churches that I grew up, where we would say, "Order my steps in your way, dear Lord. Order my steps in your word." Philippians and Numbers lead us toward that ordering this morning. When we look at Moses and we see how he was overwhelmed. Now, just in case you forgot, there was this guy named Moses in the Hebrew scriptures. And remember, I'm slowly trying to get us transitioned out of using the phrase Old Testament. But in the front of the Bible, we're reminded that he had a major responsibility. He had a great calling from God. He had so many things on his plate, he couldn't seem to balance the time out with the needs. And so the Lord said to him on several occasions, and in Numbers, we see just one more of those occasions where he said, "Okay, take something from your plate and give it to Aaron's sons. Give it to those who would be their descendants from now until eternity, that they would be the keepers of the temple. They would be responsible for the rituals and the sacred rites of those who follow in my ways." That Moses, you got enough on your schedule. You can delegate that. Now, he didn't say you can forget about that. Sometimes people in leadership think that delegating means that I gave it to so-and-so and now I can forget about it. When you are truly in leadership, you can never forget about something. But when you delegate, you can relax. You can know that it's being taken care of. You can focus and put your energy in other places, knowing that that important role or task is being dealt with or accomplished, and all you have to do is just kind of oversee it and support them. Now, one of the things that the confirmation class supplies me with is plenty of examples to share with you. And one of the things one of the young persons said a couple weeks ago was, you know, Pastor Brad, when you read those scriptures or when people read the Bible in church, I'm lost. It doesn't mean anything to me. If it's more than 7 or 8 words, I'm off in another world. So I pray that you didn't go off in another world as Rachel shared those words with us this morning. But when I think about this example of how God led Moses to share, how God led Moses to say, what you have on your schedule is important, but somebody else can help with that. And by allowing them and inviting them and entrusting and empowering them, you will be able to focus on other things that I have called you to do. He didn't say worship wasn't important. He didn't say the rites of their faith were not important. He said Aaron and his sons could take that part over. And then I'm reminded in the book that we're reading, or at least I'm reading, and some of the ladies are in Mom Squad, The Best Yes. Again, I recommend that book to you. That it talks about these overwhelmed schedules and underwhelmed souls. And so when you bring Moses being overwhelmed and God showing him a different perspective, I won't say the right perspective, but I will say a way of coming to some sense of balance. Another story finds its way into our minds and into our sharing this morning. It seems that the author of The Best Yes is not a sports fanatic, but yet the story of Dick Fosby rose to her mind, and it seems that Dick was one of those people who was an innovator and ahead of his time when it came to track and field, and he developed a technique of, they call it the Fosby Fly, of when you are high jumping over that little pole and you land on a big pad, something that looks like a big king-size mattress, just 2 times bigger, and he would have them to approach the bar and then twist and go over backwards. This was totally innovative for his day and age, but it allowed him to move outside of the restraints and the parameters of what tradition had dictated. The traditional way of approaching the bar, going over head first, facing the bar, limited the ability and the height at which one was able to clear the bar. And so he saw a different way to accomplish something greater for what others would believe would be impossible. Again, I think that's part of moving toward a balanced life. That is the desire and the ability to look beyond tradition, the ability to look beyond what is already being done, the ability to say, Lord, what is it that you are sharing with me that will help me to accomplish the tasks that are given to me and even exceed at some points the expectations or the parameters of those tasks. When I look at my schedule, many times I see things that have to be done. Most of the time there are things that I did not choose, but they have to be done. And yet there is a yearning in my heart to achieve more. There's a desire to figure out what is on that schedule that God has truly called me to be about, so that I might answer with my best yes. Now, some who might not have been here before, you might have forgot, that best yes thing is, there's yes, and there's no, and then there's God's best yes. And when we structure our lives, when we order our steps, as that old hymn would say, according to God's word, then we are able to clear time out, clear white space out on that schedule so that God can speak to us. And so that it's just not full of tasks and obligations. Now, I live in the real world just like you. There are so many of those tasks and obligations that have to be done, have to be accomplished. We can't get around them. But yet, there is that window of opportunity, that amount of space, no matter how you calculate it. If you were to go to thebestyes.com website, thebestyes.com website, there's a tool there available for you to figure out how to calculate what that white space time, what that God development time, that time to dream and explore what it is God would have you to be or to do, how to calculate how much of that time each of you has and each of us has. Now, one author said out of the, 168 hours a week that God gives us to mess around with, maybe 3.5 hours is white space, maybe less, maybe a little more. But that when we allow others to write in that white space, and then we don't have the time to write in it ourselves. Sometimes we need to be like Dick Fosby. We need to think outside of the parameters. Sometimes we need to be like Moses and be willing to not give away our responsibilities, but just to invite others to be responsible with us for those roles. When we do those things, then we will be able to embrace what God has given us. Then we will be able to take tradition and move beyond the parameters that tradition would set for us. When I think about living like this, two phrases well up as a result of the reading. She talks about living proactive lives and not reactive lives. Proactive, again, is where we take that white space time, that 3.5 hours or whatever it is, and we write in it before our boss can write in it. We write in it before our spouse can write in it. We write in it before our children can write in it. We write in it before our parents can write in it. We write in it even before Brad can write in it for you. We write in it what our dreams and our aspirations are. And we say, Lord, I'm going to spend some time dreaming today or this week, and it's going to be on my schedule. It won't happen if we don't put it on the schedule, Ted. It won't happen. Somebody else will write in it for us. And for us to truly have overwhelmed souls and not underwhelmed souls, we've got to claim that time. We've got to claim that dreaming and exploring time. For some people, you might want to be writers like our author. For some people, you might want to build something or create something. Go off in your shed, Chuck, and build something. For some people, it might just be exercising. You want to achieve a certain physical stature in your life, and so you schedule to work out and to exercise, and that will give you joy. For whatever it is, some people might want to be writers and painters and creators. But it's not wasted time. I've heard people say to me, Brad, I just don't have time to waste on my dreams. I've got things that have to be done. Everyone has those have-to things. But if we don't claim those dream things, if we don't claim those soul-stirring, inspirational points in our lives, we will be overwhelmed. Our schedules will always be full. Our souls will always be underwhelmed. To me, that is the opportunity that we are invited to embrace this morning, to claim that white space, to claim God's best yes. How do we know if we are underwhelmed? A person who lives with the stress of an overwhelmed schedule will often ache with the sadness of an underwhelmed soul. If you're living with the stress of an overwhelmed schedule, you have not claimed that time. You have not sought, well, what is it God wants me to do to reinvigorate myself and recharge myself? It doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are. All of us need that recharging time. Some people will say to me, Brad, my recharging time is in front of a big screen television set with some type of beverage in my hand and just sitting there not talking. Well, I'll give you that might be enjoyment time, and I'm gonna give you my opinion on that, even though you never asked for that. That's not recharging time. You need to be working towards some dream you have had. Everybody's got a dream. Many of us have given up on our dreams. Many of us have said that's what teenagers dream about. That's what young people think about. That's what people with no children and no spouses and no bills and no responsibilities and no expectations have. But when we claim that dreaming time, we will structure our schedules so that they are representative of God's time as well. Remember, this is not just our time. It's the time that God invites us to dream about busting traditions and busting expectations, moving in different directions. And even if we never become a published author, even if we never achieve that Coke bottle physical physique that we might desire, even if we never are able to get to that height of heights in that dream area, just the effort of attempting it, it's not only therapeutic, but it's spiritually fulfilling. I'm reminded of a conversation I had with Rachel a couple years ago. Now, Rachel, this was in the sermon before I knew you would even be religious. That she asked me, what was my dream for this congregation? What was my ultimate hope about our ability as far as reaching people? And I said, you know, that could be assessed on several levels, but one of the key assessments for a worshiping community of faith is who shows up on Sunday morning. And so I love for our average worship attendance to approach 200, to exceed 200 every week. Some say, well, Brad, what's magical about 200? Are you saying that we just need to get numbers for the sake of getting numbers? No. Experts, people a lot smarter than me, have assessed that 200 in worship allows a congregation to be a vibrant, thriving, alive group of people. That you have enough people who want to participate in different aspects of missional outreach or educational enterprise or of worship leadership, that you have enough people who are of a means who can support those endeavors financially, that you have enough people who are there adding energy and life to your congregation, that you will be able to thrive when you have crossed that number. For most congregations, that is a magical number. Yes, we all read about and hear about it, and I'd say most of us have probably been to the mega churches, and they're in the thousands. But the average church in America only worships around 100 a Sunday. They are always struggling. They're always talking about how we can't pay the next bill. They're always wishing that the people down the street would go to their church. They're always talking about what they used to do and used to be in the history. But when you cross that 200 mark, for some reason, there is enough energy and enough life that yes, you may honor your history and your past, as we did a little bit last week, but you don't live in the past. You are living and dreaming and working toward the future. Some look at me, and when I say things like that, they get quiet. I don't know why they get quiet, but they get quiet because they say, but if we actually cross that 200 mark, things might change around here. We don't really want things to change. We just want to be able to pay our bills, Brad. We just want to be able to come and see a few folks on Sunday. We don't know if we really want things to change. But if you are not changing for the positive, you're changing for the negative. If you are not growing, you are dying. There is no in between. Actually, most of us, I'd say all of us, unless we are like Jesus, from the moment in which we come into this world, we are growing and dying. We are dying to things of the past. We're dying to abilities we used to have. But we are growing to the new opportunities and to the new heights that God will take us. Now, quite frankly, I have been excited about what's been going on in here and around here. Sometimes I get so excited that I look back at my schedule and there's absolutely no white space. But in the midst of that excitement, in the midst of our possibilities and growth and energy, I have to be intentional. I have to set an example for you of maintaining that white space, that time to dream, that time for God to work on me instead of me trying to work on you or on others. That God needs to work on me as much as God needs to work on you. And for me to be open to that visioning and that planning and that dreaming opportunity, I too have to set time aside. What time of the day do you set aside for God to work on you? What time of the week do you set aside for God to work on you? Yes, those things will help us to not have underwhelmed souls and to not be overtaxed with our schedules. When I think about Philippians again, Philippians 2, the 3rd through the 7th chapters, I like that first verse there, verse 3. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourself. Now, so even as I'm preserving that white space, even as I'm carving it out, I'm always dreaming about how will this affect others? How will me being more balanced and more calm and more focused affect my relationship with my wife? How will me being more concerned and sensitive and dreaming about what could be affect my relationship with my adult children? How will me being more focused and concerned about what is it that God is calling us and me to do and to be affect my relationships with you? Now, again, when I think about this, a phrase pops up that came out of our reading this week. How do we honor God with the time we have? See, when we focus on ourselves, when we carve out that white space, it's another way of honoring God. It's another way of saying, Lord, write on me. Help me be that person you have called me to be. And when we do that, we honor God. When I think about that, I just get excited sometimes. I get excited because I know that when we honor God, when I honor God, good stuff is going to happen. Does that mean that I'm not going to have some stress? I'm going to have some stress. Does that mean we're not going to have to work with balancing out goals and achievements? Yeah, we're going to have to balance it out. I'm reminded of a conversation I had with a person I regard as a friend this week. And this person said to me, I asked him to help me with a relationship situation. And he said to me, Brad, somebody once said churches and schools would be wonderful places if you didn't have to deal with people. But I say it's the people that make it fun. It's the people that make it exciting and engaging. And in the midst of those relationships, yes, there will be challenges. Yes, there will be opportunities to grow. But the opposite of those opportunities, the opposite of the stress that comes with relationships is being alone. None of us can be in this world alone and be happy and be fulfilled. The same for our community of faith. If there isn't any stress going on, we must not be growing, because that means we're not engaging other people and other ways of thinking and trying to build relationships with others. Today, I pray that you choose a fearless path, as our author would say, like Dick Fosby or Moses. Today, the words of the best yes ring in my ears. Don't get locked into your overwhelming schedules, that so much so that you haphazardly spend your soul. It's time to flip that. Never is a woman or a man so fulfilled as when they choose to underwhelm his or her schedule. Get that. You need to underwhelm your schedule so that you can let God overwhelm your soul. I'd invite our worship leaders back up as we continue to think about, and I hope later, look at your schedules. Most of us have our schedules digitally nowadays, so when you go to your Google calendars or whatever mechanism you use for scheduling, you will carve out time for God to speak to you. You will carve out white space so that you can be the best that God has called you to be, even if it's just time to dream. This morning, as we have come together from our busy lives and busy schedules, some of them overwhelmed, I pray and I hope that you will choose to have an overwhelmed soul as you work on an underwhelmed schedule. Will the ushers please come forward?
All about you, Jesus.
And as I was listening to Brad, it just kind of hit me that I hope this song speaks to you and that we don't just go through the motions.
Continue to seek God's face. Amen.
Amen.